respect. You're gonna get charged, you better watch your fucking neck. Take the past, burn it up and let it go. Carry on, I'm stronger than you'll ever know. That's the deal, you get no respect. You're gonna get charged, you better watch your fucking neck.
Aside from a well-hydrated German Shepherd with a full bladder, nobody's happier to see a fire hydrant than a fireman, especially when something's on fire. But before you hook into this and commit your truck to it, you better make sure it's in working order and ready to go. I'm Chief Rob Wiley. This is another Fireground Flash Tip. Once you've got your hydrant spot and you know you're going to use it, you're usually stopping to drop off your jump man. That's when it helps to have a handy hydrant bag or a board that has everything you need on it to deal with that hydrant. Spanner wrenches, a hydrant wrench, a valve to convert for extra water supply if another truck comes in. The other thing you want to have is a radio. Radio communication is a must. I know in the old days we used to wait for that long air horn blast to send the water, but if somebody honks the horn to get somebody out of the way, there's nothing worse than seeing 1,200 gallons a minute coming ripping up that hose and you don't have it connected to your truck yet. So have a radio for communication, affirmative communication with your driver operator that he's ready for water. The first thing we want to do when we get to the hydrant is we want to spin off. This is a three-way hydrant. When you get a three-way hydrant, you want to use the largest port. You're going to get the most water for the less friction loss. Spin that cap off. I loosen this one up for expedience. You want to physically and visually check that thing out. Make sure there's nothing in there. We found everything from tennis cans to beer bongs in there. So make sure there's nothing that's going to block the water coming up. And worse yet, nothing you're going to suck into your pump. The next thing you want to do is make sure this thing works. So you're going to want to give it a little bit of a crank. Every hydrant's different. You can hear it coming now. You give it a little bit, make sure we're going to get some water. You know, there we go. Good clean water. Shut it back down. We know nothing flew up out of the bottom, no garbage that was in the bottom that'll get into our pump. Now we're ready to hook in our large diameter hose line. The other thing I recommend you do before you turn this thing on is put a hydrant valve on it every single time. Take one of your ears if you got a three-way, or if you got a two-way, the other side of it, spin that cap off, visually, physically inspect it for debris, and put a valve on it. This way, if another truck comes off, they can use this hydrant as well. Otherwise, it's set for one truck only. If you've got a valve that'll fit on that steamer port, put that on there too. That way, if the hydrant fails, the stem snaps, you can't shut it off, you can close the valve and disconnect your truck, and you're not stuck there for 8 hours waiting for the water company to show up. Fire hydrant can be your best friend, but it can be your worst enemy if you're not ready to deal with it and you haven't checked it before you engage your truck. Remember, when you get off the truck, take all the tools you're going to need with you. Using a hydrant bag or a hydrant board or some other mechanism to have all the tools you need with you at once is a great idea. Don't forget to take a radio. Don't count on an air horn to have the right time to send water to a truck. That could be a disaster. Remember to always visually and physically inspect the inside of that barrel before you connect your hose to it. Flow a little bit of water to flush up any garbage or debris that might be inside. You suck that into your pump, you're done. Make sure you have a valve on the hydrant at all times. This allows another truck to use the same hydrant for supply. If you've got one for the steamer port, put one there too. That way, if the stem breaks in the hydrant, you can't shut it off. You can close the valve and disconnect your truck, and you're not stuck there all night waiting for the water department. A fire hydrant close by to a working fire can be a firefighter's best friend. but it can turn into your worst enemy if you don't prepare. If you don't take a couple of seconds to make sure that this hydrant's doing what it's supposed to do and the way it's supposed to do it. I'm Chief Rob Wiley. This has been another Fireground Flash Tip.
To demonstrate is the proper donning of the firefighting ensemble of turnout gear in SCBA. I start off with stepping into the boots and the pants, pulling the pants up around the waist, placing the suspenders in place, zipping the zipper and Velcro or any snaps that may be involved, placing the SCBA Nomex hood in place, donning the turnout coat, placing my thumbs through the gauntlets at the wrist, putting the zipper in place and any Velcro or snaps that may be present, collar Velcroed in place, hood back, and ready for the SCBA. SCBA involving the coat method, tightening up the shoulder straps, the waist strap, and now placing the SCBA face piece on, chin first, jaw straps, temple straps, head in place, covering all skin, helmet, chin strap tight, on air, checking the pressure gauge at 4,000 pounds, donning the gloves, and I am ready to go to work.
Shit, different day, can't keep fed if I can't get paid, well I'll be dead if the shit don't change, standing on the edge of a revolution.
Yeah. I'm Ernie Rhodes, and this is a Fireground Flash Tip. Today we're going to talk about using your radio on the Fireground. When I'm on the Fireground, communications is very important. And what I find a lot of times after a hot wash is guys don't hear their radio or lose communications because they're not managing the radio properly. What I used to do when I was a firefighter, I would make sure before I got on the scene, take my radio out, make sure it's on the right channel. I would place the radio inside my pocket of my pants, secure the pants pocket. I'd bring the lapel mic up and around my neck to secure it, and go ahead and fasten my turnout gear together to create my protective envelope. Zip it up, fix my collar, and then bring the mic around where the mic would lay right here. This has a lot of advantages. My cord's not going to get hung on any debris or any obstacle. I know where my microphone is at all times. I can hear it. It's close to my ear versus strapping it on my SCBA where you can't hear it. It's further away and you can get it caught on something. And then when you hear it and it's dragging around, you're dragging the mic behind you, trying to find your microphone in the heat and the smoke. It's very difficult. So I know it's right here. So I can talk on it real quickly if I need to talk to operations or another company. And then also too, if I need to switch channels, all I have to do is reach down into my pocket and turn the channel. Because on your radios, you should memorize where your channels are by the clicks or the notches in the radio itself. That's a Fireground tip. Thanks for watching, and I'm Ernie Rhodes.
I think everybody would agree a well-equipped, professionally trained dispatch center is a lifeline for firefighters and emergency responders in the field. But if we don't do our part, it's all for naught. I'm Chief Rob Wiley. This is another Fireground Flash Tip. We're here at the St. Charles County Department of Dispatch and Alarm. This is a state-of-the-art agency. They handle over 45,000 emergency calls a year for 10 different fire departments and a countywide ambulance district. The thing you've got to remember, they've got 500 watts combined transmitting power that's coming out of this place through five different sites. And on the other end of it, we're trying to talk back to them on as little as 5 watts. Remember, if they can't hear us, if they can't understand us, they can't get us what we need, they can't help us. A few things to remember. Common courtesy. When you're on the radio, try and listen for a minute before you key up that mic and make sure the radio is clear and nobody else is on there that you're going to step on. The other most important thing is make sure that your voice is clear and concise. Remember, 5 watts trying to travel a long distance has a lot of opportunity for breakup. So the clearer you can speak, the more concisely you can speak, the better the message is going to be received in the communication center. One of the things we still see across the United States is places that use 10 codes. 10 codes are a thing of the past. Use plain text, plain English. That way there's no misconception, especially if you're in a mutual aid situation and they don't know your codes as well as your own communication center. So speak English. Tell them what you want. Tell them what you need. Be concise. Be clear. The other thing to worry about is background noise. A lot of times, I can't tell you how many times you hear a guy key up from inside a fire and you hear nothing but feedback. That's because everybody on the crew's got their radios on, cranked up all the way. Try and set it so whoever's going to speak on the radio, be it the company officer, whoever, has his radio up, everybody else turn theirs down. Leave them on so they're functioning, but turn them down to minimize the feedback. Once you get your message and you send it out to dispatch, remember a couple of things. They're blind in here. They don't see what's going on. They can't hear what's going on. Their only point of reference to this incident is what you're telling them. You've got to paint the picture for them so that they can prepare, so they can help you, so they can get other resources lined up. And other resources means shorter time for delivery on scene, more help for you. So paint that picture. Dispatchers are the unsung heroes in emergency services. Imagine the frustration of taking a phone call from a parent whose child isn't breathing. They have no idea where they are, what town they're in, what road they live on, which direction to travel. And now you've got to, as a dispatcher, put together an action plan, get resources on the road to help save that child. We've got to remember that in the field. When we get out in the field, they're blind. We're their eyes and ears. We have to paint a picture for them so they understand the scope and the magnitude of the situation. That allows them to proact, to think ahead, get resources lined up. The better they can do that, the shorter the time we have to wait for them. All the technology in the world, all the training in the world are for naught if we don't do our part from the field. Remember, keep your communication short, concise, to the point. Use plain English text, no 10 codes. The other thing you want to do is key that radio up, wait a beat, and then speak. Make sure you've established that link. Also, make sure the radio is clear before you start to talk so you don't step on somebody else's vital traffic. From the St. Charles County Department of Dispatch and Alarm, I'm Chief Rob Wiley. This has been another Fireground Flash Tip.
I was just reading this story in FireRescue1.com in the news section about a kid in California who gave up what looked like a very lucrative pro baseball career to join the fire service. It got me thinking, this is a great profession. We've taken our knocks. The love fest after September 11th is over, boys and girls. We got to earn our keep, just like we always should have been. But when you see all the knocks in the paper about they make too much money, they don't work hard enough, we're getting in trouble for things we put on Facebook, we're getting in trouble for getting in fights, we're getting in trouble for DWIs. That's tough stuff to take, and it makes everybody think a little bit less of our profession. But I'm here to tell you, people love firefighters and people respect the fire service. The key here is we got to live up to that respect. We got to live that every single day. Here's a kid giving up what could have been a multi-million dollar pro ball contract to be a member of our profession. That should tell you something about the regard people hold us in. And as I said, the key now is to live up to it. And living up to it doesn't mean just being a good firefighter on the scene, being able to go in and save somebody's life, put out a fire, be a good EMT or a good paramedic. It means living the life all the time. That means on duty, off duty, whenever you're out, you're identified in the fire service. People know who the firefighters are, and they watch what they do. Like it or not, we're role models. Is it fair that a fire chief that gets pulled over for DWI winds up on the front page of the paper and an average citizen won't? No, it's not. But guess what? It's reality. We're in the public eye. People hold us to a higher standard. They hold us to a higher regard. And we've got to live up to that every single day. It's tough. And we got to help each other with that too. When you see somebody slipping off the path a little bit, kick them back in. The fire service has been around for a long time. It's our job to build on the legacy that was left to us by those that have gone before us and to build a legacy for the ones coming in behind us. We've got to walk the walk and talk the talk. That's the way the fire service is going to progress. When you see a kid giving up a baseball contract, a pro baseball contract, it reminds me of Pat Tilden when he gave up his NFL career, an established NFL player, to go into the military and serve his country. That's the kind of folks we want in the fire service. The people that are committed to their communities, the people that are committed to a cause. Do I sound like a zealot? I am. I'm a zealot for the fire service. You've got to promote it every day, not only in what you do, but what you say and how you act. I'm telling you that every day people watch us. They use us as role models, and they watch every single thing we do. Fair or unfair, that's the facts of life. We work in a great profession, a very proud profession, and we have to carry the torch forward. So every day, live the profession, live up to the expectations and the high pedestal that we're put on as fire rescue professionals. I'm Chief Rob Wiley, and that's what I think.